Hi, everyone. I'm Ashley. I'm a librarian at the Public Library of Youngstown in Mahoning County. In honor of Native American Heritage Month this month of November, we have a special presentation from the Mahoning Valley Historical Society. So Traci Manning is here with us today to talk about Native Americans in our valley, the history of Native Americans in our valley. So I'm going to pass it over to Traci.
Thank you so much, Ashley. I'm excited to be here to talk about this topic. And I'll kind of set it up a little bit because our human history here goes back well over 10,000 years. So to try to shrink 10,000 years of history into a presentation that you can sit through, we're definitely not going to cover everything. So stop when white European settlers get here to the Mahoning Valley. So we're not going to be really learning about the interactions between the settlers and the Native Americans who were still living here. So that's kind of when we're going to stop. We're going to look at prehistory, all the different eras of Native Americans who've lived here, and then we'll kind of stop when we hit the late 1700s or so, when we have the first white settlements here. So I'm going to share my screen here and make sure you guys can see what I'm seeing. There we go. And if I seem to be looking down a lot, it's because I've got notes in front of me. So I want to make sure I get dates and times and places correct. So like I said in the kind of introduction there, we're going to look at different eras of Native Americans. So to do that, we first have to figure out how people got here to North America. And a lot of people know that this is happening during an ice age, and folks are traveling over the Bering Sea, which was the Bering Strait at the time, because it was completely frozen up there. So to walk from the Asian continent to the North American continent, probably not easy, but definitely doable because it was a frozen land bridge. So this is going back well over 40,000 years ago. And human history, if you've studied any types of anthropology or just the history of humans, goes back to kind of Western Central Africa. And that's well over 100,000 years ago. So the migrations from Africa kind of spread out over the centuries. And then it's about 40,000 years ago when folks are getting into North America. And on this map, you can see kind of two routes. And this is a very simplistic map, of course. But the red route would be looking at the land routes that folks are getting here. And then there are some folks who believe that there may have been sea travel as well. So natives kind of working along the shore of the Pacific Ocean and the Pacific Rim there. Archaeologists have done obviously a ton of research on this, but we're talking 40,000 years ago. So a lot of things archaeologists just don't have. We don't have great history from this time period because it's so long ago. So we're piecing together these small finds that we can find all over the continent to put together our best guess of when and where these things are happening. Now, another thing I like on this map are the different shades of green, if you will. So we kind of have this medium shade of green, and then there's a lighter shade of green. And that lighter shade of green would have been the glacier. So you can see about half of North America was covered in a glacier at this time. And if you kind of zoom into where we are, just south of Lake Erie, you can see right along the Mahoning Valley, this was a shelf. This was an ice shelf. So we would have had glaciers here and then, you know, just kind of regular Arctic tundra at the time. So that's why we see such an interesting geographic and geologic formation as the glaciers would have melted over the last, you know, 40,000 years. So that's, I really like this map. It's simple, but it tells a lot. And then I have another one here because I want to talk about a couple of the sites that archaeologists have clued in on. And you can see there's a site kind of right near where Pittsburgh could be, and that is the Meadowcroft Rock Shelter. And if you visited the Meadowcroft Rock Shelter, you may know some of the history about it. It's a fascinating site. But if you look at the dates there, this is going back to 13 to 12,000 BC. So we're looking at potentially 15,000 years ago, there were indigenous people living in our area, in this region. Pittsburgh might seem far away today, but in the grand scheme of things, it's really not. So the Meadowcroft Rock Shelter, our best guess, goes back about 15,000 years. So to say that folks were also in our area at the time, I think we can kind of say that yes, we would have had human beings moving through this area around 15,000 years ago. And I think even for historians and archaeologists, trying to imagine these times is crazy a little bit. You know, we think about a human lifespan today and we're lucky if we live to be 100. And so that's kind of an easy round number to think of, 100 years. Well, now we're taking that and we're looking at 15,000 years. And that's kind of a lot to deal with in our minds of just how long ago that really was. So let's take a peek here and think about what's happening in that time period. So I'm going to go back to about 16,000 years ago as well, because this is when we're really seeing migration heading east of the Rocky Mountains, kind of coming into the middle of North America, and then heading out to what is going to become today the eastern part of the United States. So let me just take a peek here. So I mentioned that this is all kind of happening during the last ice age, the last major ice age. And at the height of that ice age, which was about 23,000 years ago, is when that ice shelf is really at its peak in our area. So it's going to start melting around that time of 23,000 years ago. And again, 23,000 years ago versus 20,000 years ago might seem like a lot, but again, in the grand scheme of things, even 3,000 years is not really a lot when you're looking at something that's so big. So let's talk about these Paleolithic era indigenous folks here. So one of the names we see are Paleo Indians. Now we know that the term Indian, of course, comes from European settlers getting here to the North American, Central American continents, and Central American area, I should say, and believing that they had hit the subcontinent of India, and that is where the name Indian comes from. So a lot of folks will use the term Native American, and a lot of folks will use the term indigenous people as the first peoples who were coming to this area. But the Paleo-Indian era, the Paleolithic era, you can see the time periods here. So we're looking about 14 to 10,000 years ago. And in this time period, we're seeing very small groups of people that are following really, really big animals and gathering fruits, plants, things like that. So this is very much the hunter-gatherer time period. And we see that, how many of you have heard of the paleo diet, right? Where you eat protein and you eat things that grow naturally. So that's where this comes from. These were very migrant people. They probably had no permanent settlements anywhere. They are following the animals as the animals are migrating. They are moving with the seasons. They are moving when resources are depleted. And if there were conflicts with other bands of people, that might move them as well. But I think these groups were so small and isolated that I'm not really sure conflict was something they had to worry about in that time period, at least not on any grand scale. And you can see some points here on the screen. These are Clovis points. And the Clovis people, these are kind of, it's the name that these first indigenous people will become known as. The Clovis points are found around, like I mentioned, about 13,000 years ago. And the Clovis people, like I said, these are about the first folks who are here. And some of the animals that they are following, I think these are kind of fun. We have mammoths, of course. I think mammoths are really cool, and I wish we still had some somewhere. Mastodons, giant sloths. How fun does that sound? A giant sloth. Camels. Did you know we had camels here in North America? Bison, of course. Lions and saber-toothed cats. The lions would be much more like our mountain lions or the cougars we have around this area today. Dire wolves that weigh about 150 pounds. And then how about this one? Beavers that could be about 8 feet tall. Yeah. So this is coming straight from an archaeologist. I have never seen evidence of an 8 foot tall beaver, but I really hope it's true because that sounds really fun. And also terrifying, an 8 foot tall beaver. So these are some of the animals that we would have had around here. A lot of these animals are going to die away very, very quickly. This is also a time period where there are horses natively on this continent that have come over from the Asian continent and live in the North American continent natively, naturally. But all the horses will die out eventually. And they're not reintroduced until the Europeans come here thousands and thousands of years later. So I'm just checking my notes again. I want to make sure I don't miss anything. Most of these bands of people were about 20 to 60 members. And of course, that would vary based on where they are and then also the time of year. We do see that there's evidence of fishing. And then we've found evidence of exactly what you would expect with the gathering. So seeds, nuts, berries, edible roots, and those sorts of things are what the Clovis people would be eating. So in hunting, you can imagine hunting a mastodon, not the easiest thing in the world to do. It's pretty massive. We take a look here at this great comparison between the mammoth here, I should say, the mammoth and a human being. So taking on one of those by yourself, probably not going to be successful, but using a whole team of hunters and then different types of tools, we're looking at spear points, projectiles, and so on that would be used to take down animals like this. And an animal like this is going to give so much of its self to these people. So not only are they going to have the fur and the skin, they're going to have, of course, the muscles, the meat that they're eating, other organs that they might be eating as well. They're going to have the bones, the tusks, anything, the teeth, anything that they can use from these animals, whatever animal it is, they're going to find a use for. You've got to imagine the only resources that these people had were what was available to them naturally in nature. So using anything that they could, they're really not going to waste anything because why would you do that? Why would you waste something that you could have a use for? So in this time period, there's really no evidence of any types of containers. So there's no jars or pots or bowls left behind, whether they would have been pottery or wooden or even skin, something like that. It's most likely that containers they would have used would have been just destroyed over time. So something that would have completely gone back to the earth, like a skin container or a bone container. Something like stone or pottery might still be preserved, and we have no evidence of that. So it's most likely it was some kind of very natural material like skin or wood or bone, something like that. So I mentioned here we have the American mastodon, the mammoth here, and these became extinct around 10 to 9,000 years ago. So they're not here for a very, very long time, and that's mostly with climate change. Climate change isn't something we're just dealing with today. It's something that they were dealing with then as the Ice Age was depleting and melting away. So all of this is going to lead us to our next time period, which is the Archaic Era. And this is happening from between 9,000 and 4,000 years ago. So we're looking at a span here of 5,000 years. Again, these are really massive periods of time, and they're by no means, you know, to the day. You know, if we're looking at 9,000 years ago and then 9,000 years ago in one day, there's really no, it's very, very gray, these eras. So in this time period, all of that big game was gone from the land. So the mastodons, the huge 8-foot-tall beavers that were probably around here somewhere, they're all gone. So now the groups are hunting much smaller game and still kind of following them with groups of hunters. They're still gathering food at this point, and there's evidence of some permanent winter settlements. So we see a little bit of evidence there that folks were living, at least for some portion of their year, in one spot and not constantly moving. And then there's also evidence that they were coming back to that same spot year after year. We do see in this time period what really sets it apart. Excuse me, I'm gonna grab a quick drink of water here. What really sets this era apart from the Paleolithic era are those stone vessels. So I mentioned that in the Paleolithic era, they're not really using a type of container that would have been permanent in somehow. But in this time period, we are seeing stone tools and stone vessels and containers. So that's one of the big differences between those two eras. And you can see the points on the screen here are different than the Clovis points. So the Clovis points tend to be a little bit smoother on the edges, and they don't have that notch in the back that would have really attached it to something. So the way that they would have attached to whatever they were using, if it was a spear or something like that, would have just been a little bit different style there. So really, the change in climate is another massive thing that affects the different eras here between the Paleolithic and the Archaic era. We have bands that are very, very migrant in this time period because the weather is unstable. It's not going to be like today where we have these consistent seasons with some minor changes as time goes on. This is going to be very unstable weather. So that's going to force these folks to really move around a lot. And they're going to move for the same reasons as well that their Paleolithic ancestors would have, including following the game if there are depleted resources, anything like that. In this time period as well, we are seeing some of the foundations of kind of more permanent culture, if you will. So a lot of the traditional creation stories are being formed in this time period. So this is a very important time when we're seeing more folks come together, and we're still kind of small. We're still small groups of people, but we're seeing some more come together. We're seeing these creation stories. We're seeing some permanent settlements, even though they might only be temporary for a certain time of the year. So then in this Archaic era, we also have, we can break that down into a late, a middle, and an early. So the middle era of this Archaic era, we're going to start to see those earthwork mounds that a lot of us have heard about. We've traveled, we've seen them, and these mounds are very much for religious purposes. A lot of these mounds would have been burial grounds, or they would have been some type of ceremonial location. Many of these are seen throughout the southern United States in this time period, and then we start to see them kind of moving a little bit north. In our area, we're not really seeing mound building until the late Archaic era, which is looking to be about 3,000 to 4,000 years ago. So a little bit later than, later than the folks kind of in the southern part of the United States. So that late Archaic era, like I mentioned, we're seeing sites along the Mississippi River Valley and then up into the Ohio River Valley. We're seeing effigy mounds as well, and some different types of mounds and shapes. So I love this map here. I think this is a coloring sheet, but I really like it because you can see some of the different locations. The big water, of course, that's Lake Erie. And then where we live over here in kind of the northeastern part of the state, it's covered in trees. And by this time period, that's what this place would have looked like. After the ice ages moved on, the glaciers have melted and things are warming up again. This was a massively dense forest. The entire eastern half of the United States, really from the Mississippi River to the Atlantic Ocean, all the way south into, you know, what would have been, or what today is, you know, places like Mississippi and Florida, and then all the way north into the Canadian tundra, was a forest, a dense hardwood forest. Of course, there's going to be the same types of hills and mountains that we have today, but the land very much was a forest. And our part of northeastern Ohio was especially dense. And we're going to see how that affects what's going to happen over the next few thousand years. So I love this little coloring sheet with our little forest up there in northeastern Ohio. So this is going to take us to that woodland era. And the woodland era is basically defined by the fact that they lived in the woods. And that will really go for almost half of the United States would be considered woodland, Native Americans, because half of the United States was a forest. We're looking back about 3,000 years ago in certain areas. And then only, you know, a little over, I have to do some math here in my head, subtracting. So about 3,000 years ago to just a little bit less than that, maybe 2,600 years ago or so. And this is going to take us essentially to pioneer settlement, to that white European settlement. But there is a little tiny era we're going to talk about next, after we talk about the woodland era. And what sets this era apart from their ancestors in the archaic period are that they have started cultivating crops. So not only are they going to be hunting meat and fishing and so on, they are going to be gathering the same things their ancestors did, but now they've cultivated crops. So we're seeing farms, we're seeing agriculture come in, and that's going to form the basis of their society, and it's going to form the basis of what they eat every day. And now we have permanent settlements, some migration from site to site, and then trade routes being established from different tribes and groups along the East Coast. So these are the Native Americans that European settlers would have met. These are the folks that we definitely know more about, not just because it's more recent, but because we have that contact from white European settlers who would have written things down. Native American history is an oral tradition. They shared their stories from generation to generation. So we don't really have written records of what they, you know, what their history was. We have oral traditions, we have stories, we have artwork, we have, you know, different engravings on pottery and other things like that. But it's a different way of keeping history, whereas the European settlers were known to write things down into books. So these are the folks we kind of just know a little bit more about because we have those written records that we can add to the oral traditions and the artwork and so on that are left from the folks themselves. So in this woodland era, we also see migration on a much larger scale. I love this painting here of two gentlemen in a canoe. These cutout canoes could have been made from a cutout tree, or they could have been stretched with animal skin. And they're using these waterways to really move around. And so many of our waterways today are named for what the indigenous people called them, or even how they used them. Places like Portage County, to portage your canoe is to take it out of the water, carry it over the land because the water is not deep or wide enough, and then you can put it back in the water somewhere else. So you would have portaged from one water system to a different water system. Pennsylvania has the same thing. I actually grew up in a town that was the first place. It was called Canoe Place. It was the first place on the Allegheny River that you could get your canoe. So we have Portage Creek up there. So a lot of these places, they're very similar throughout the eastern part of the United States. And even our term Mahoning is an Algonquin-based word that means at the salt lick. So many names come from these Native American traditions. And I'll talk about the salt lick in a little while here, because that's where our name comes from. So in that woodland era as well, we're seeing some different cultures come up. We're seeing the Adena culture, we're seeing Hopewell traditions, and then the Mississippian cultures, which we'll talk about in a bit here. We're seeing that we have developments of much more technologically advanced tools made out of bone and leather, stone. We're seeing textile manufacturing, so the weaving of materials, the tanning of hides and animal skins. Cultivation, of course, being the most important thing in this time period. And then also some shelter construction that is going to be very similar to what we kind of know today of where Native Americans would have lived. We're seeing different types of weapons, including spears, atlatls, which would kind of throw projectiles, and then, of course, bows and arrows coming around in this time period as well. So let me keep looking through these notes here. So also in this time period, we see that, like I mentioned, the Hopewell culture coming out. Ceramics are something we find a lot of from this time period. And then we're also seeing, again, that culture really building. So this is when stories are coming in, the religion and culture of these different groups are becoming very powerful and popular. And we're seeing that reflected in what is left behind. So in looking at this map you have on the screen here, these are just some of the different tribes and then the languages that would have been spoken in this area. Most of these languages have their bases in Algonquin. Algonquin kind of predates all of the others. So think of it, this is a terrible analogy, but kind of think of it like Latin and then how other languages kind of spring from it and have their roots in it. So even though French is very different than Latin, it has its roots there. So Algonquin language is kind of that one that predates everybody. And in our area, we would have had kind of an ancestor of that, or a descendant of that, I should say, in the Iroquois. So this is the fun thing about our part of Ohio, because school students in Ohio, when they pick up their textbook and they're learning about Native Americans, who are they learning about? They're learning about the Miami, they're learning about the Shawnee, and none of them lived here. Our part of Northeastern Ohio was this weird buffer zone, and also a very dense forest that honestly had no permanent settlements, nothing that would have lasted longer than a generation or two. And in the span of 2,000 or 3,000 years, a generation or two isn't really that long of a time. So this buffer zone is going to separate our area and then further southwest into Ohio from heading into what's today kind of that Erie area of Pennsylvania and then into western New York. And who lived there? The Iroquois, and specifically the Seneca Nation, which will become part of the Iroquois Nation. And they were known to be quite aggressive. And this area kind of became a peaceful buffer zone between different tribes. So between the Iroquois Confederacy and then tribes to the southwest of us here. So that's why our part of Northeastern Ohio doesn't really have the types of Native Americans that most school students study. You know, students will ask me, well, what was this tribe doing? And I'm like, well, they didn't live around here. So most of the folks we have here would have come from the Lenape or the Delaware tribes or some part of the Iroquois Confederacy, most likely the Seneca Nation, and then possibly some Erie as well, though a lot of that evidence pushes them a little bit further to the west, maybe out towards the kind of Canton, Akron area, and then heading up towards Cleveland. So, looking at the Mississippian era. So this is a time period that some folks do separate out. This specific part of the woodland era happens a little bit later, and then again, it kind of reaches to the pioneer settlement of white European settlers. Really only happening in certain regions. And at this time period, those systems and networks of trading were very well defined and organized. There were roads, and a lot of these roads are the same roads that those white European settlers are going to use. And some of them even formed the basis for roads we're still using today, because they were the easiest routes through the land. And the Mississippian era is kind of defined in this map here. So what is setting these folks apart are some of the villages. And when you look at where we are on this map, I know you don't have your state lines on this map, but if you look where we are, we're really not in a Mississippian culture here. We're kind of just on the edge of it. But because folks were so migrant at that time period, it's very possible that we would have had Mississippian influences with some of those types of mounds and traditions in the same way that we would have had Iroquois and kind of Northeastern tribe traditions here as well, kind of coming together right here at the kind of the base of the Mahoning River and so on. So what's happening here? We'll talk a little bit about that. I love this map. This is a great map of trails and where folks are living kind of as white European settlers are getting to this area. Now we know that even in the 1600s, we are seeing trappers and traders coming into this area, but none of them are living here permanently. It's not until the late 1790s that we're seeing white permanent settlers coming out here. But if you take a peek up in the northeastern corner, you're going to see the Salt Lick in 1760. So the Salt Lick is Mahoning. And if you think about Youngstown and Salt Springs, and then you've got kind of that Spring Common area, this is that spot on the Mahoning River. And the land had a ton of salt in it. So at the Salt Lick is Mahoning. So we would have had folks traveling here to get that salt out of the ground, salt being used for so many important things. So even though we might not have had permanent villages or towns here, we would have had folks visiting this area to get those resources. And you can see some of the trails here, that Salt Lick Trail that kind of heads southwest. You've got the Mahoning Trail that would be a little bit further south of kind of the Youngstown area, maybe along where the Western Reserve Road is today. I've never overlaid this on an Ohio state map. But I should do that someday. But you can see the river there and how it's sneaking over into western Pennsylvania. So these would have been kind of the defined routes and trails and known villages of folks living here at the time of that first white European settler contact. So that migrant lifestyle, like I said, in this woodland era, even though we have permanent settlements in so many tribes across the nation, not here. This was a migrant spot. They're traveling here to hunt, to gather resources, to get the salt. They may be traveling up to Lake Erie or traveling further south. But in this area, northeastern Ohio, not a lot of permanent settlements. So very migrant movement around here. And I love these two images here, this painting. You can see they're taking their canoe out of the water. They're portaging their canoe there to take it to a different water system. And then this photograph on the other side, you can just kind of see some of the things they would have had. You know, tools that were made out of stone and wood, the food that they would have eaten. And then down at the kind of middle of that picture is a small, it almost looks like a wooden container, but it's actually made of tree bark. So they're using a lot of different natural materials to make the tools that they would have needed. The types of houses they would have lived in, wigwams would be the most common type of house, because these are relatively easy to build. It's nothing that you're going to live in full time. This is something you might spend a couple months out of the year in, or even less than that. But the structure, of course, made of branches, and then the kind of walls are birch bark. So a birch tree is a fantastic example of using resources, because you can cut the birch bark off of the tree and it'll peel off in a big sheet. So you can actually use that birch bark to kind of be your drywall, if you will, for your wigwam. In the one picture, you can see that dugout canoe, which is quite literally the trunk of a tree that they have dug out, and that's created their canoe. And then in the other picture, the one that's a little bit lighter in the fall season there, the stones on the inside would have been the fire pit to keep them warm. And then on the roof, you can see that there's this kind of weird, like, extra roof part. And that would have been a chimney that they could have opened and closed to let the smoke out as the fire was burning inside. So in those permanent villages, I apologize that this one picture is coming up quite blurry. I hadn't noticed that before, but the other one's pretty clear. So in permanent villages, even though we really didn't have any around here, this is what they would have looked like. So a very circular wall on the outside, not only to, you know, have some defense, but really just for kind of safety from the natural world outside of them as well. Farming will take place outside of those walls, hunting, so on, all those sorts of activities. But within the walls, you would have had all of your homes, different ceremonial sites, your food storage. Everyone used everything together, so it was very much a community effort in farming and hunting and gathering and so on. So nothing was individualized as we would think of it today, and families very much lived together, and we see that in examples like this of a longhouse. Now, the next couple images are modern day images. These are from a museum in New York State that has rebuilt some of these for folks to visit and see what they looked like. So they're very accurate. That's why I like to use an actual photograph, because I think it's just really nice to see it in real life. So these longhouses are absolutely massive. If you take a look at that door, that's a normal size door. So these were huge, huge structures. And we're going to take a peek on the inside. Obviously, this is a modern picture because there's a woman in the middle taking a picture with her cell phone. So this is a very modern picture. But you can see what the insides would have looked like. You would have had different levels on either side for sleeping, for storage. You would have had attic space where they could hang things to dry. They would have had types of pulley systems to move things up and down. You can see there's very large skins hanging there, potentially also drying or separating the spaces. And then in this next photo, you can see these fire pits in the middle, and those lights at the top, that's of course not a light, it is an opening for the smoke to head out. And they would have been able to open and close those, and it would have let light in and it would have let the smoke out. I also love this one because they have a canoe in their attic. I think that's kind of neat. So maybe it was winter time and they didn't have to worry about their canoe, so they would have put it up there for storage. And then you can just see some of the other materials that these folks would have had. And then this particular longhouse is coming from a time period where we would have had some European connection, because you can see some of the fabrics there and so on that they would have traded with European settlers. but a great insight into what these homes would have looked like and also how they're structured. You know, you see these massive tree trunks that are building this structure and how they're tied together. I think it's incredibly impressive how these massive structures were built. Of course, hunting in this time period, we're not seeing the massive game like we had 10,000 years ago, but we will still have some larger deer, folks in the deer family, not really any moose around here, but potentially elk in this area, and then much smaller game as well. So you would have had your rabbits and your ducks and your squirrels, and then you would have had your bears, of course. In this time period, we're seeing the eastern woodland bison is starting to die off. So we would have had bison here, looking back over 3,000 or 4,000 years ago. They were smaller than the bison out in the Great Plains, but they were still bison. But at this time period, they've kind of been killed off and they've died off. So they are extinct by this time period. So looking at what they ate, I absolutely love traditional corn or maize because it's beautiful. The corn that we eat today has all been genetically modified over the last hundreds and hundreds of years to be either white or yellow, where natural corn, natural maize comes in so many stunning, beautiful colors, just like so many of our other fruits and vegetables do, like peppers and apples and so on. So I absolutely love how gorgeous some of this food really is. And cultivating comes from being able to modify seeds. So cultivation in itself is genetic modification. So we really have been doing that for thousands and thousands of years. And that's what sets this time period apart. So the number one food in their diet, of course, is corn. There's an old adage, no idea if it's true, and I don't want to test it out, that says you can eat corn 1,000 different ways and not have the same meal twice. I don't like corn enough to do that, but apparently that is some kind of truth. And with corn, we know you can have it fresh, like we're used to corn on the cob or the stuff that comes out of the can or the freezer section, or you can dry the corn. And then from that, you can crush it into cornmeal. From the cornmeal, you can make breads and flatbreads and tortillas and all those yummy, delicious things. And also popcorn. Popcorn is an indigenous food. I was watching a great episode of Alton Brown. And if you're a fan of the Food Network, you know who Alton Brown is and his Good Eats show. And he talked about the fact that popcorn is thousands of years old here in the United States. And it was folks kind of living towards the Southwest. So your kind of Nevada, Arizona area that first popped their corn. So we have them to thank for popcorn, which is awesome. The other two foods they're eating a lot of, and all three will combine to be called the three sisters. So corn is the biggest of the three sisters, and then beans and squash. So beans being, you know, white beans, black beans, and so on, great sources of protein, and then squash. There are so many kinds of squash, and there are kinds of squash that don't exist anymore. There are new kinds of squash that are being created. But of course, you have all your zucchinis, your summer squashes, your butternut squash, your pumpkins, all of these different types of things. And they would have been easy to keep. If you think about all of these foods, they're foods that are very easy to keep. They're hardy. You harvest your squash at this time of year, and it's going to last for a very long time. And of course, they're still hunting, they're still gathering, but it's those three foods that are going to form the bulk of their diet. These are some examples of how folks might have dressed. These examples are specifically from Iroquois Nation. I mean, you can see things that are made very much of animal skins. Decorations could have been like the bear claw necklace that the one gentleman has. You could have had wooden or glass beads. You may have had, you know, other animal parts like feathers and so on. So these are just some of the examples of what folks might have been dressing like. And then I love this painting here. This is a group of Iroquois, and I think, again, this is a great example of how folks would have dressed. A question I get asked a lot, especially when I'm giving this presentation to children, we have a Native American program we take out to schools, is how did men and women dress differently? And in a lot of ways, they kind of didn't. You see women wearing pants, you see women wearing kind of tunic or dresses, and often the men are wearing the same thing, maybe just a tiny little bit different style. So in this painting, you can see that evidence here. They would have been wearing leggings or pants of some sort, and then some kind of longer tunic over the top. So that's something that I think is very different from our cultures. This is a time period where, you know, 500 years ago in Europe, men and women dressed very, very differently. But we're not really seeing that here. The dress here is much more for necessity. It's to keep yourself protected, safe, comfortable, warm, and so on. And then you would have just decorated on top of that. So using those colorful glass beads, using different pieces from nature, like the bear claws, the feathers, and so on, to just kind of set yourself apart from the next person. And their daily life, you know, students were educated, the young children, I should say, were educated. Of course, there's games and different things that they would play. And we do have evidence of pets. We have evidence that tribes at this time period have dogs that have been domesticated from their wolf ancestors. And we do have dogs living with these folks. And the same thing's happening in Europe. But I kind of love that. I love the idea of these domesticated wolf descendants that have become the pets for these different tribes. We see some different games, of course, that folks would play. And then a lot of our sports have their roots in indigenous cultures. Lacrosse probably being the most famous. This, of course, being an indigenous sport that was actively played and competitively played as well. Another sport that has its roots in this culture is long distance running. And kind of all your track and field type of events. So running was something that not only was done out of necessity, but was done as a sport and as an activity as well, and potentially competitive. This other painting here, you just see a group that is gathering together, maybe getting ready to have some dinner together or something like that. So just gonna run through my last set of notes here, because all of this is going to lead us to the European settlement. So when we finally are transitioning from prehistoric Native Americans to historic, and that is purely a white European definition, prehistoric being folks who had oral history traditions, and historic folks being the ones who wrote things down. So there's very much, it's just the way history was kept. So this is where we switch from prehistoric to historic as European settlers are coming in and writing this history down. So of course, coastal tribes will meet the Europeans first. And then we're looking at about 500 years ago that fur trappers and traders are going to wander inland. They're going to head west of the Allegheny Mountains, following the Ohio River Valley, the Allegheny River Valley, and so on. And then as settlers kind of move further west, of course, they're going to be meeting different tribes as they go. And one of the reasons I try to kind of end this presentation around this time period is because from here, we're heading into 400 or 500 years of very complicated, nuanced, and destructive history as white European settlers are forcing indigenous people from their lands, and you know, Native American relations are still something that's very important today as we're looking at modern day politics. So by the late 18th century, which is when the first permanent settlers are gonna get here, for the most part, we have Lenape and a few Iroquois still wandering through this area. And by the time folks like John Young and that whole group of people get here, they're really not seeing a huge number of Native Americans. In Joseph Butler's History of the Valley, there are some stories, some anecdotes of relations with the local Native Americans. But for the most part, they were not a permanent tribe here, and it was just kind of individual incidents as folks would meet them. So many of these natives who had lived here had kind of already been pushed westward from places in New York and Pennsylvania. So that's why we're seeing more Iroquois and Lenape coming through here. And then they're just going to continue to be pushed westward. So in this time period, we are seeing some relations with what will become the United States of America. We're seeing some treaties and so on's coming out. And it was actually in 1786 that we had the first Native American reservation. It wasn't in this area, but the very first one goes all the way back to 1786. And the government is trying to approach each tribe as a separate independent nation. And this policy stays intact for more than 100 years. But within that 100 years, President James Monroe in 1821 is not really happy with how the relations with Native Americans are going. And he mostly just says that he's concerned for the plight of the Native Americans. But in reality, his administration pretty much removed them from all states north of the Ohio River. So by the 1820s, unless you had folks that were just sticking around and possibly kind of moving into a more white European lifestyle, all of the Native Americans had been forced from this part of the United States. Now, in that time period as well, you have the French and Indian War, you have the Revolutionary War, you have a lot of other connections between Indigenous people and the white European settlers. And I would love to go into that, but that's another program because that takes a really long time to look at those connections between the two civilizations as they come together. So that is where I'm going to leave you, kind of at the edge of your seats of what happens when those two civilizations come together. And Ashley, we're going to just have to do that program sometime to talk about kind of what happened in the last 250 years.
Absolutely. That sounds wonderful. Yeah. If you want to stop sharing your screen there, if that's the end. Thank you so much, Traci. That was fascinating.
Oh, thank you.
I hope everybody else is enjoying this at home too. Let me see if I can switch this here so we can see both of us. There we go. So thank you again for being here with us today. Absolutely fascinating stuff. I'm definitely stuck on the 8-foot beavers right now. I'm
right
having a hard time imagining that. But just so everyone knows, Traci will be back with us next month in December for History of Christmas. So we'll be doing 19th Century Christmas on December 15th at 6 p.m. So tune in for that. And thank you so much for being with us, Traci.
Thank you. This was fun.
Absolutely. Okay.